This morning, would you like to turn your Bibles to 2 Samuel? Can I have my specs from there? 2 Samuel chapter 6. Now, this is something that we already are familiar with. Sometimes familiarity breeds contempt. And that's what I'm about to set to prove today. 2 Samuel chapter 6. I know there are many seasoned Christians here today. Some of you may be fresh in your faith, but there are many who are seasoned here. So for those of you who are seasoned believers, this may be something that you already heard so many times. But I think sometimes even seasoned Christians need to hear basic truths from the scripture. 2 Samuel chapter 6. Then David again gathered all the elite troops in Israel, 30,000 in all. He led them to Baalah of Judah, to bring back the Ark of God, which bears the name of the Lord of Heaven's armies, who is enthroned between the cherubim. They placed the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it from Abinadab's house, which is on a hill. Uzzah and Ahio, Abinadab's sons, were guiding the cart as it left the house, carrying the Ark of God. Ahio walked in front of the Ark. David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, singing songs and playing all kinds of musical instruments, lyres, harps, tambourines, castanets, and cymbals. But when they arrived at the threshing floor of Nacon, the oxen stumbled and Uzzah reached out his hand and studied the Ark of God. Then the Lord's anger was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him dead because of this. So Uzzah died right there beside the Ark of God. David was angry because the Lord's anger burst out against Uzzah. He named that place Perez Uzzah, which means to burst out against Uzzah, as still called today. David was now afraid of the Lord. And he asked, how can I ever bring the Ark of God back into my care? So David decided not to move the Ark of the Lord into the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom of Gath. The Ark of the Lord remained there in Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. Then the king was told that the Lord has blessed Obed-Edom's household and everything that he has because of the Ark of God. So David went there and brought the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with great celebration. After the men who were carrying the Ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps, David sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, wearing a priestly garment. So David and all the people of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and blowing of ram's horns. But as the Ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked down from her window. When she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she was filled with contempt for him. They brought the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the special tent David had prepared for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. This is a very interesting passage. If you've never heard of this story before, this is a story at once shows a man dancing, another man dying, another man getting blessed. The same story, in just the span of 16 verses, you see 3 different people who had 3 different experiences in their lives. One, a man who's dead on the spot, another man who was blessed, another man who danced with all his might in the presence of God, in the presence of Ark of Covenant. All 3 of them have one thing in common, and of course that is the Ark of the covenant of God. A rectangular box commissioned by Moses, basically commissioned by God, representing his presence among his people. When Israelites were brought out of Egypt and they were on their way to the promised land, God said that it is my desire that I dwell among my people. So I don't want to be a distant God. I want to be closer to my people. That was the desire of God. I want to dwell among my people. Now, if I dwell among my people would die. So instead of killing them, let me ask you to prepare something that represents my presence among his people, among my people. That was the primary reason why the Ark of God was prepared, representing the presence of God among his people. This chest is not really one, it's a very small one. Technically, it's just about 3 feet, 9 inches tall and 2 feet wide. 2 feet, 3 inches wide and maybe a feet and a half in its depth. Three most important Hebrew artifacts were kept inside that box, commissioned as commanded by God. One, a golden jar of unspoiled manna, which represents the providence of God for his people. In 40 years of their journey, from the time they moved out of Egypt, crossed the Red Sea, to the time they entered into the promised land, they didn't have space where they could cultivate and grow crops or make money and buy food or nothing. So therefore, God took care of them by providing their daily needs, every day's bread, by sending food from heaven, which is called manna. So in order to remind people that I am there to take care of you, God asked them to take a jar of gold and fill the manna, unspoiled manna, inside that and keep it as a remembrance. That as long as I am with you, you shouldn't be worried about how your life will be taken care. I am there to take care of you. Whether you have a job or no job, whether you're making money or not making money, whether you're coming from a family that has inheritance or a family that has nothing, as long as I am with you, I will put food on your table, I will make sure your children are studying, I will make sure your life has everything you need. Providence of God. The second one is an artifact which is called Aaron's rod, basically Aaron's staff, which Aaron would carry with him. Aaron was as a representative of Moses and later on became a representative of God to his people because God separated him to be a man and his family to be people who would be representing God as priests. In order to show that this person is anointed, God had made sure people see that this person's staff, which is technically a dead wood, sprouted again and budded again with life. Just to show people the anointing of God upon him, in his hand, the staff which got life now. It's supposed to be a dead tree, a staff that is carved out of a dead tree, which means there is no chance of life again. But God purposefully asked Aaron to put it in his presence, and then next morning when it has, when they retrieved it, it has now life. It sprouted. There's a bud on a dead wood. That's not possible, right? Sometimes God does those things in order to show others there is the evidence of the hand of God upon the people whom he has chosen. So he did that for Aaron's sake, for Aaron to understand that God is with them, but most importantly, to show people this is how the power of God works. Wherever the presence of God is, there is power. That there is nothing called impossible in the dictionary of God. For people to remind themselves that even though our situation today may look impossible, may look hopeless, as long as the presence of God is with you, you can be assured of this fact that there is nothing that is impossible with God. All things are possible with God, just like how life can come out of a dead wood. I can bring life out of your dead situation. That's a reminder to people of the power of God. And of course, the third artifact that they were asked to keep inside the Ark of Covenant was the two stone tablets on which God wrote His Ten Commandments, His precepts for His people, His will for His people. When God gave those Ten Commandments, He's telling His people, virtually, do what I want you to do. This is my will for you. In our language, it is the Word of God. The Word of God for His people, the will of God for His people as it is revealed in the Word of God. So, wherever the presence of God is, the will of God would naturally be expressed. The will of God should be followed and would be followed. So, it is a reminder to His people that wherever my presence is, my will be done in that place. So, the Ark of the Covenant is a very significant one in the life of Israelites because it reminds that wherever there is a providence of God, wherever there is a power of God, display of the power of God, wherever the precepts of God are followed, there the presence of God is. And wherever the presence of God is, there is providence, there is power, and there will be His precepts. It's a significant one. And so, the Ark of Covenant represents the presence of God to His people. It cannot be neglected, it cannot be ignored, but unfortunately it has been ignored for a long time in that land, and David has now become the king. He's just got his kingship over the united Israel, and then he decided that I cannot survive as a king without the presence of God at my home. So he wanted to make sure the thing that represents the presence of God would be at his home, the Ark of Covenant. It's just 7 miles away, about 12 to 15 kilometers away from his town where he is now ruling from, Jerusalem, in a place called Bala of Judah. It was in a house of a person called Abinadab. It's been there for more than 20 years. Why it is there for 20 years, we'll talk about it in a moment. But it's there. Nobody really bothered about it. Nobody really is visiting it. It may be gathered dust. Oh, I don't know what's happening there. But he thought, that's not the place it should be. It should be in the place where, you know, I am ruling from. So he wanted the presence of God in his home. That's why he called for people and said, let's just get the Ark of Covenant to here with great procession. He conducted a big parade, calling 30,000 of them. They went together to Abinadab's house. Then David commissioned two of Abinadab's children, Uzzah and Ahio, to make sure that the Ark of Covenant is brought to the city of Jerusalem. Uzzah and Ahio prepared a new cart on which they put the Ark of Covenant, and they were bringing it. As they were bringing it on their way, the wheel, of course, of the cart caught in a small pit, maybe, something like that, a place called the place of Nacon. And as the oxen stumbled, the Ark of Covenant, which was on the top of the bullock cart, was about to fall, and Uzzah, naturally, like any one of us, just stretched his hand and touched it. The moment he touched it in order to stop the Ark of Covenant from falling down, God killed him on the spot. Just like that. It must have been a severe death. David has seen many deaths in his life. In fact, he killed many people, so he knows how death looks like. He's not newbie to blood. He's not somebody who has never seen gruesome murders. He is somebody who's seen death a lot of death. But that death scared him. It must have been a horrific one when God struck Uzzah at Nacon's floor. Something that nobody has ever seen. The death was such unique one, such distinguished one. The way God murdered him, if I have to use that language. I don't know if I can use that language. Caught even a veteran like David completely off guard. He got scared. I like the way the whole story pans out. You know, David goes in celebration mode, he's dancing and he's coming, and then he got scared. David was afraid of God. Bible says David was afraid of God, not the situation, God. What kind of God am I serving? That fear has come into his heart. And he thought, I don't think I can ever get this into my home. So he looked for the nearest home that he could find and took the Ark of Covenant there and placed it there. A guy called Obed-Edom. Who is Obed-Edom? I have no idea. But I do know later on he became one of the court musicians of David. He is from a city called Gath, which simply means he's not a Jew. He's not a Hebrew. He's a Gittite. Basically, another way of saying he's a Philistine. So the Ark of Covenant ends up in a non-Christian's home. Our language. And the interesting thing is, as the Ark of Covenant enters his home, God begins to bless him. Bless everything that he does. Everything in his household began to multiply and became such a big news. Over the next 3 months, God blessed this non-Christian who does not follow this God. So much. He must have blessed him so much. I mean, really a lot. It's not a 5,000 bonus or a small promotion. It must be a big blessing. So big that blessing was, David came to know about that blessing. The king, who's got many other things to do, in fact, before the news reached out to him, he was involved in two different wars. David was very busy fighting Philistines in the battlefield. So he was actually very busy. This king came to know that this person got blessed. Must have been a big blessing, huh? And so he thought, no, I can't let that blessing go to him. I want that blessing. So he goes back and now brings it back. On his way, giving sacrifices to God. Again, celebrating as the Ark of Covenant entered into his home. That's the gist of the story, basically. The one that we've read. He begins with celebration. Then he witnesses a murder, death. And then, of course, he gets to see God as somebody who scares him, as a distinct one. And then he begins to see how this distinct God is blessing everybody else. Finally, he decides, no, I can't just ignore the presence of God. I got to have it. So he brings it back with celebration. Starts with celebration, ends with celebration. In the middle, he's gone through a lot of emotions in the presence of God. As you see, one man killed by God, one man blessed even though he's not a Christian, another man dancing as he brought. He was dancing with such joy and such might that what he was wearing was falling off him. That must be some club dancing, huh? Hip hop. Must be. Clothes are falling off. His wife somewhere there, sitting there in our palace, looking through the window, could see this guy is becoming naked as the clothes are falling off. Indecent he's become. Bible says she looked at him with contempt. From there she looked at him with contempt. Sometimes when you worship God, others will look at you with contempt because they can't worship you. Worship God like you, by the way. So don't bother about those guys. She was with contempt, filled with contempt. As he walked in, she said, are you not the king? I mean, you're supposed to be decent, right? Decent Christian. You're supposed to be decent Christian. How come you're not a decent Christian? Worshipping God like that on the streets like a mad fellow. You made a fool of yourself. That's what she said to him. You made a fool of yourself in front of everybody. Look at how people are laughing at you. Now that must have been a really bad dance. You never see David dancing any other place in the Bible. David singing, yes. David writing songs, yes. David dancing, this is the only occasion you get to see. He never danced in the Valley of Elah after he killed Goliath. He never danced. He went to battlefield with against Philistines, kills of them, never danced. You don't see him doing breakdance or anything. This is the only time he's doing that. And that must be a really bad dance. That's why she didn't like it. But apparently God doesn't mind it. Because God didn't do anything there. You would expect horrific death that Uzzah got, David should also get, right? I mean, Uzzah at least was decent enough to put his hand up in order to stop a Ark of Covenant, that is a very important thing, from falling down and gathering dust. On the other hand, you see this guy who is indecent and dancing is completely shamelessly, without bothering about anybody and without minding his own state of dressing. God seems to be silent. He seems to be enjoying it. I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, how come all three of them have the one thing common, that is, of course, the Ark of Covenant. All three of them, which means the presence of God. If all three of them are in the presence of God, but all of them had three different experiences, completely different from each other. Same presence of God, same Ark of Covenant, same jar of manna, same staff of Aaron, same two stones of God's precepts, same Ark of Covenant that has the mercy seat, same, everything is the same, the presence of God is the same. But three different experiences. I gather that this morning, either you are Uzzah, or you are Obed-Edom, or you are a David. One of that. As I looked at this and I wondered, sometimes the way we sing and pray, we don't even think about what we are singing and praying. You know, God, can I enter into your presence? If this is what's going to happen in his presence, I don't want to go. God, can your presence come into my home? If that's how it's going to end up, it's scary, right? Right? Anything can happen. If the presence of God is there, anything can happen. I don't know what could happen in your home or in your place and in our church. If this is how confusing the presence of God is, should we pray for the presence of God? Should we ask God to come into our home? Should we enter into his presence or not? A lot of confusion. We desire as a church the touching and the helping and the healing presence of God in our midst. But what if the presence of God comes with death and horror and murder and butchering and all that stuff? What if that comes into our lives, into our midst? How what should I do now? How do I react here? There is a clear teaching in this passage, in this whole incident, that took 3 months, by the way. It's just one paragraph, one chapter, but it actually is in the span of 3 months. The whole thing took place in 3 months. There's a lot of truths that we need to learn about the presence of God and how we behave in the presence of God. Three truths I want to teach you today that I've learned from this from this passage, and three lessons that we must all learn. Because if this is how God is going to behave, then I might as well get our clarity on how do I, understand the whole thing. Number one, truth number one. God's presence, we must know, is a privilege. The thing is this, that for most of us, we assume God's presence is a program. That Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, I walk into Dream Center, and from then to 12 o'clock, if pastor doesn't preach too long, then to 12:30, that's the time I set for God. This is when God needs to come in. As I walk in, the song should be so good that it should stir up my emotions and I should start crying and I should lift my hands. I should feel the presence of God. And because I'm spending 2 hours time in the presence of God, then God should speak to me and answer my problems, solve my problems, give me healing, and then I should go out here happy. For us, God has become a genie in the bottle. That you demand when God should come. You set your expectations on how God should behave in His presence and what He should speak to you, what He should do to you. You got 2 hours time for God. It's a privilege that we could walk into His presence. That God has not stuck us down till now like He did Uzzah. It's not a parade or a program that you look at the presence of God and demand what you want from Him. God comes when He wants, goes when He wants. Does what He wants, says what He wants. You don't get to say anything to God. Uzzah missed out that. God doesn't enjoy killing them. But He had to do that because people lost their reverence for the presence of God. David thought he could just do whatever he wants. Uzzah thought he could do whatever he wants. See, there is no awe of God. No awe of God. No awe of God leads to death. Not necessarily like him, physical death. It could be death of your career, death of your business, death of your marriage. It could be death of your relationships. It could be anything. God starts putting His hand over your life and pressing it down, you will not be in a position to bear it. We better be careful in the presence of God. See, God cannot be cajoled, commanded, conjured up, or called down whenever we want. He's a personal God, yes. He loves, He heals, He helps, He intervenes. But He doesn't respond to your commands. He looks for reverence. He looks for obedience. He looks for God-hungry hearts. Then He responds. God won't be loaded onto convenient wagons that we prepare and touted as we want Him to be by dumb animals, you know. Don't confuse Him with some kind of genie that you could rub out a lamp and then a butler would show up. God comes, mind you, God comes. But He comes on His own terms. See, God's presence is neither a parade or a program. It's a privilege for us. That you get to stand in His presence is a privilege. Some of us don't even want to get up and worship Him. We're like, बहुत हो गया आज आ गया चर्च को बस है. We have no reverence in the presence of God. When the worship is, people are, leading you into worship, you have no mind to lift up your hand to offer your worship. You're not doing it for these people. You have a privilege to be in the presence of God. Don't miss that. Don't think you're doing a favor to God. Actually, God is doing a favor to you by letting you alive. Uzzah had to learn it hard way because he took commands and neglected what he's supposed to do. Here is the lesson for us. Commands of God must not be obeyed with complacency. Uzzah is doing what God, what is expected of him, to bring the covenant of Ark of Covenant to the Jerusalem. But he just ignored what he's supposed to do. When the Ark of Covenant was made, Moses very specifically designated a family who are supposed to take care of the Ark of Covenant. Of course, God was speaking through Moses and he told him what to do. This family, how they need to take care of the Ark of Covenant, how they need to behave as you come near to the Ark of Covenant, how you need to offer sacrifices, consecrate yourself, wear a particular kind of clothes when you come to clean the Ark of Covenant. And when you, after you do that, before you carry it out, then what do you do? Go back, consecrate yourself, reconsecrate yourself, change your clothes and then come back and then carry the Ark of Covenant. You are supposed to carry it wherever it goes, from one place to other places. The list of things is given in the book of Leviticus. These are like rules, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, list of things. How do you behave? How do you, do serve the Lord? Everything. Clear-cut instruction to Kohathites, a family called, Kohathites. Uzzah and Ahio come from that family. Uzzah and Ahio, that means, know what they are supposed to do with the Ark of Covenant. They know, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is how I need to behave in the presence of God. This is how I need to obey the commands of God. They knew. Now, Obed-Edom, on the other hand, doesn't know. He's a non-Christian. He has no idea what Christianity is, what Christ has done at the cross. He has no clue. So it's okay if he got blessed. I can understand. He has no idea. David may have half knowledge. But this guy, he knows. He knows how to obey the commands of God. How to behave in the presence of God. His job was to carry the Ark of Covenant. But what did he do? He looked for a convenient way to do his job. Complacency towards the commands of God. I mean, I wonder how did this complacency had come. Remember I told you it's in somebody's house for 20 years? It's gone there because nobody wanted the Ark of Covenant. 20 years ago, Israelites were at war with Philistines. They took the Ark of Covenant into the battlefield, assuming that wherever the battlefield, wherever the Ark of Covenant is, there is victory, right? That's what they assumed. So they carried the Ark of Covenant into the battlefield, thinking, now that the presence of God is here, I can be victorious. But unfortunately, they lost the match. So now it taught me a lesson. It doesn't matter, even if the presence of God is in the battlefield, if you are supposed to lose, you will lose anyway. Lost. They lost because their hearts were not in the right place. 30,000 Israelites were dead on that day in the battlefield. In the middle of battlefield, when the presence of God is there. So that means you can die in the church also. That's what I mean. Even though the power of God is in your home, still you may face losses. But we are supposed to be successful, right? We're supposed to be not failures. Presence of God. So presence of God is very much related to the condition of your heart. That's the point I'm trying to make. So they lost it. Philistines took it. And of course, God took his revenge on Philistines anyway. For the next few days, or as long as they had it, two towns were completely destroyed by God. Philistines' towns. They got scared. So they built a bullock cart, a new bullock cart, and put the Ark of Covenant on that and sent it along its way to Israel. There you go, you see? They didn't die there on that day. But Uzzah did the same thing, exactly the same thing, but God killed him on the spot. See the difference between the guy who knows what God wants and who does not know what God wants? That's a danger with us Christians. That when we know what the will of God is and still don't do it, this is what will happen to us. Somebody who does not know the will of God, they're spared. You know it. You know how to behave in the presence of God. You know how to obey the commands of God. And still you don't do it? There you see, that's called complacent behavior. If God didn't kill Uzzah on that day, the entire nation would have taken God for granted. Uzzah must have seen this Ark of Covenant in his home. As the Ark of Covenant came into the land of Israel, to a place called Beth Shemesh, I think. A village. The Israelite village. Everybody was curious. They wanted to see what is inside that. Because it's been more than 400 or 500 years since the Ark of Covenant is already made. And so they're very curious what's inside. They only heard about the story. So the villagers came, opened the mercy seat, and they were looking down inside. Because they did that, God killed everybody there. Some old manuscripts say 50,070 people died. That's an accurate number. 50,070 people died on that day. Just by opening the Ark of Covenant. And so everybody got scared. They didn't know what to do with this. They called for a priest, a Kohathite priest called Abinadab, whose son is Eliezer, and told him, please take it from here. So Eliezer took it to his home, Abinadab's. That's how it stayed in Abinadab's house. For the next 21 years, nobody bothered to think about it. They're Christians. They call themselves their followers of Jesus Christ. They get blessings from Jesus Christ. But they have no inclination to think about the presence of God. No, not even a single thought of where is the presence of God. You could be 20 years as a Christian and never thought about the presence of God at all. Zero. So David wanted it to come. I'm thinking in these 20 years, as Uzzah and Ahio grew up around the Ark of Covenant. See, from the day it came, it stayed in their home, right? So when they get up in the Ark of Covenant, when they're having their breakfast at the dining table, they see the Ark of Covenant. When they're playing on the field, and back home, they see the Ark of Covenant. When they're family gathering, gathered together, have celebrations, they see the Ark of Covenant there. They're talking and chatting, watching TV. Ark of Covenant is there. Everything that they're doing with all their friends, the Ark of Covenant is there. They grew up. Your children, like Uzzah and Ahio, grew up around the Ark of Covenant so much. So much they saw it, so much they heard about the church, so much they saw, so many preachings, so much they heard, so many songs, they played so many songs, they may be even part of the worship team and singing songs, they got used to God. No more reverence of God. Complacency. So God killed Uzzah. No wonder God killed Uzzah. No wonder some of us never experience success. That all our efforts are still in vain. No reverence inside your heart for God. No obedience to the will of God. You know who your God is. You know what He wants from you. But you live your life in such a way as if to say, I don't care. Somebody who does not know Christ, I can understand. has no relationship with Jesus, I understand. But you? What's wrong with you? That's why he thought, it's okay, I can give a second-rate worship to God. Bullock cart only, no. I'm not disrespecting God, I'm putting it in bullock cart. Who wants your new bullock cart? He wants you to carry it on your shoulder. That was the command. Carry it on your shoulder. That was the command. Not bullock cart. Maybe parents, be careful how we allow our children to get used to God. Let's not let them get used to God. Let's remind them of the sacredity of the presence of God, of the church, of the people of God, how they need to learn to respect the people of God, the presence of God. I'm not really surprised God is angered. He didn't put himself in a place, Uzzah didn't put himself in a place where he was offering with reverence, where he was obeying God with a truthful heart, obedience, where his commandments are observed as they were given to him. Some of you are going to look at me and say, well, that's the Old Testament. We are in New Testament. Because the blood of Jesus has given us a new and living way, we can enter into his presence with confidence because he has now opened the door for us. Oh yeah, absolutely. But the point is, how did the door get open? The presence of God is precious, you know. Somebody had to pay for you to have an access to the presence of God. I mean, thank God somebody paid for it. Otherwise, we'll all be dead. But today, we are alive and breathing and listening. And still have confidence that we can go out from here alive. Because somebody paid for it. Now, before Jesus died on the cross for you and created an access for you, nobody has access to that. The Ark of Covenant was not accessible to everybody. Once in a year, when it is in tabernacle, and if it's not moved, when it's in tabernacle, nobody approached the Ark of Covenant. For an entire year, nobody would even go near to it. It's in the Holy of Holies. If you come with us to Mount Carmel, you have seen how the whole tabernacle setup would be done. Once in a year, a priest would consecrate himself, high priest would consecrate himself, and on behalf of all the people who would enter into the Holy of Holies, what happens inside the Holy of Holies, nobody really knows, right? God could kill him also. So that's why, just in case if there's something wrong in his heart, he would tie up a rope around his waist with a bell hanging to it. And as long as the bell, people could hear the sound of the bell, they know this fellow is alive. The moment the sound of the bell is stopped, they know he's dropped dead. So they would drag him out. That's how dangerous it is to approach the presence of God. Once upon a time. Why? Because God is a holy God. In him, there is no sin. There is no space for sin in his presence. Bible calls him a consuming fire. He consumes us. So people don't really approach the presence of God just like that, however they want. That's why there is a veil separating people from the Holy of Holies, from the presence of God. Holy, it's holy, he's holy. And so when Jesus died on the cross, the symbolic expression of that happening right at the cross, you remember the day Jesus died on the cross, the veil in the temple got torn completely, opening the presence of God for you and me, so you and I can walk into the presence of God, however we are, with confidence. Now, just because you got the option of entering into the presence of God with confidence and without any fear of death, doesn't mean the holiness of God has come down. You don't mistake the presence of God, the access to the presence of God, as the diminishing value of the holiness of God. God's holiness is the same. It never changed. God is still holy. God is still sitting on his throne. God is still the sovereign ruler of everything on this earth. Your life, your family, everything. He owns it. He's still holy God. Don't mistake access to the presence of God as a freedom for you to behave however you want in the presence of God. It was irreverence inside Uzzah's heart. He knew he was supposed to consecrate himself before even coming closer to the presence of God. Touch it. He knows he shouldn't do that. Anybody else, God would have spared. Uzzah, he didn't. I mean, somebody would have carried it to Obed-Edom's house, right? It can't fly itself. Somebody would have carried it. How come God didn't kill them? You see my point? Uzzah was supposed to have reverence inside his heart for the presence of God. Same author of Hebrews, who in chapter 10 says, the blood of Jesus by the new, you can enter into the presence of God by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us. Now the presence of God is accessible to all of us because of what Jesus has done at the cross, the blood of Jesus. But the same author of Hebrews in chapter 12 says this, two chapters afterwards, says this, offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, fear of God inside you. For God is a consuming fire. Oh, you thought God is a consuming fire in the Old Testament? In the New Testament too. He doesn't change. He's the same. God's presence is precious. It's paid for. So here is my point. Don't ever come together to worship God in plugins or in the church without reverence or any other places. In the name of God, don't gather without reverence in your heart. When you don't have reverence inside your heart, this is what will happen. Commemoration must be filled with reverence. Every time we are gathering, we are commemorating God, remembering what God has done for us. Every time we are lifting up our hands and worshiping God, we're reminding ourselves of who we are and in whose presence we are. The song is for not for your liking. The music is not for your ears. The music is for him, his ears. The song is for him, not for you. See, we better remember that we are here for God. God is not here for us. We would do well when we remember that. I know, we got so used to it. We got only 2 hours in a month, in a week, right? In those 2 hours, if pastor preaches more than 1.5 hours, our time is up. Not that I'm going to preach 1.5 hours, I'm just saying. Our time is up with God. Commemoration is finished. You don't know how hard I worked last night. I came back at 3 o'clock in the morning. Oh, yeah. Of course, yeah. Yeah. Who gave you the job? Who gave you the job? You forgot how to revere God. God taught him the lesson. To David too. God taught David. That's why David got scared of God. David is not the guy who gets scared of God. He loves God. He reveres God. But scared of God. That day, he got, oh my God. They were supposed to carry it. You know, the translation of that verse, verses 7, God struck him there for his error. The original language is a word called irreverence. And the Hebrew, actual meaning of Hebrew word is irreverence. God struck him for irreverence. That's why even though it was a genuine act of concern of holding the Ark of Covenant, God didn't spare him. David was genuine in his desire to get the presence of God into his home. But that was not the right way to get into his home, get the Ark of Covenant into his home. So here is my understanding. A right goal does not validate the use of improper methods to get that goal. Just because you have a right intention does not mean you can do whatever you want in order to get that. Right goal does not mean you can do whatever you want to get that. God taught David, David, I'm glad you want the Ark of Covenant to be at your home, but that's not the right way. He taught him. 1 Chronicles chapter 13 to chapter 15, go back home and read it. I don't have time to explain the whole story. God taught him how to follow rules. So David comes home scared. Scared of God, scared of what's happening. And then he comes to know Philistines have attacked him. They come to war. David is a new king. He's not established himself as a king. Now look at this. David is afraid of God at this point of time. When he came to know Philistines had come, now David became the previous David he was. He buckled down onto his knees and he said, God, I heard Philistines have come to fight against me. Can I go for war? God told him, yep, go. You will win this war. So David went, fought against Philistines, won the war, came back home. Few weeks later, Philistines regathered themselves. They wanted to scare off David. They came to the war. He came to know Philistines have come to this particular valley where they're waiting for him. David could have said, well, I finished them last time, I can do it now. But by now he learned his lesson, right? So he goes back to God, buckles down on his knees, and he says, can I go for war with those guys? The same guys he already defeated. He's already done this business before. He's already managed this role before. He's become successful in that already. Remember this. But again, he goes back to the same place. He says, God, can I go back to the same job? And God says, this time, go, but don't fight. Go, don't fight. Go. As you go, reach to the battlefield. Stand near the edge of the battlefield. You will hear a sign that I have come to the battlefield. That you will hear a sound from heaven. On the top of the poplar trees, you would hear the sound of a marching army. That's what God told him. That sounds funny. When you hear the sound of a marching army, you put your ears to the ground. That's how the scouts would do. Remember? They would put their ears to the ground to know whether how far the army is. But God says, not ground, look up. From there, you will hear the sound of a marching army. God already used JBLs and Mackies long before we started using JBLs. From there. When you hear that, then enter into the battlefield. When you hear that, that says God already marched into the battlefield. God taught David, I go before you. When I go before you, you win. David learned that. This is how you need to follow God. Exactly as he says. Even though it may sound ridiculous to you, because sound doesn't come from up above. sound supposed to come from down, from the ground. Poplar trees are really popular, right? They're really, really tall. So it's not like mango tree, you could just climb up and watch. The sound at the tip of poplar trees can't be heard by normal ears. But God says, wait till you hear that sound, then get into the battlefield. Here is what David learned. Here is what you and I should learn. You do what God tells you exactly as he tells you. Not an inch more, not an inch less. So David comes back. Now he understands, this is how I need to behave in the presence of God. This is how I need to obey the commands of God. He calls all his people. After he heard Obed-Edom got blessed, he called all his people. Same people, 30,000. Called all of them again. This time he told them, listen, last time we made a mistake. First of all, we never consecrated ourselves. How did you walk into the presence of God this morning? Look at what David is saying, and let's learn that. He consecrated in his heart. He said, before we go to the presence of God, let's consecrate ourselves. What does consecration mean? It is to confess our sins and accept and receive his forgiveness. Saying, God, I'd like to live my life for you. Now you're clean in your heart. You're ready to receive what he wants to do, what he wants to say. Most of us come here and go back sleeping because we are never interested in listening to what God wants to say to us. I know there are many. I know you play games on your phone while preaching is happening. How would you ever hear God if that is the kind of reverence you give to God? What's the point of coming to church also? Don't do that, lest he kills you. He learned that. I need to consecrate myself, number one. Number two, I need to do what I'm supposed to do as I'm supposed to do in the presence of God. He told them, listen, consecrate yourself. Next time when you come to the Ark of Covenant, only those who are designated to carry the Ark of Covenant must carry it. Nobody else should carry it. He told them very strictly, obey rules exactly as they were told to you. God's value never came down just because he opened himself to you. Your value went up because God opened himself to you. Do you know that? Do you know what happened to David? The second time when he went to the battlefield after hearing God, do you know what the Bible says? David realized God established him as a king. Previous, also he won the war, by the way. Before also he won the war. But now, same battle again, same enemy. But this time he realized, the hand of God is upon me. And here is the continuation of that verse. Everybody who heard the name of David were terrified in their heart. The fear of God puts fear of you into others. You see what I'm saying? David was afraid of God. People became afraid of David. So when you come to the presence of God, come with the fear of God. You will walk out as people who can put fear in your enemies. David learned it. He said, next time, no. I'll be careful. And so when he came back this time, and as the presence of God is now coming with him from Obed-Edom's to his house, he couldn't stop himself. Because now he realized the presence of God is a gift to him. It's a present. It's not earned. It's not something that he could fight for. It's something God says, I'll give it to you freely. Now he realized the value of it, the presence of God. So that's why he couldn't stop himself anymore. His presence, as it is coming, he couldn't contain himself anymore. He had to show his appreciation to the presence of God. He couldn't just let it be a regular procession. He offered sacrifices this time. Look at this. When Abinadab's house to David's house, it's 15 kilometers. But after God killed Uzzah, it went 23 kilometers away. Did you know that? Obed-Edom's house is 23 kilometers away from the David's, from Jerusalem. It was supposed to be a short walk, became a longer walk. If we don't have the reverence, this is what happens. Supposed to be quicker, will take longer. 3 months and longer distance. I know 15 and 23 may not look big, but in those days, it's a lot. Because here is what's happening. Now everybody learned they have to carry the Ark of Covenant. So they're carrying it. Ark of Covenant is not a, it's a small box, but it's a heavy box, by the way. They say, I mean, the calculations differ, but they say the weight must have been some 900 kilograms. That's a lot of weight. With all the gold and things that, you know, it carries, anywhere between 600 to 800 kilos. 100 kilos itself is a big thing. 600 kilos, leave it. So these guys are carrying it on their shoulders and walking. Bible talks about how the entire procession took place after this. For every 6 feet they carried, David stopped them and offered a sacrifice to God. 23 kilometers of walk. Every 6 feet. Every 6 feet. It's not required by God. But he paid it. He paid for it. God is not demanding for sacrifices there. But David understood the value of the gift. So he said, I am going to pay for this. I will pay every 6 feet one oxen and one calf. And now, this is not like some, let's get it in line, chop it and send it. That's not how it is. It's a prescribed way of doing things, you know, the sacrifices, burnt offerings and sacrifices. You're supposed to do it in a very particular way. God is very particular about the detailing. Wherever the Ark of Covenant, there should not be any blood. Wherever the Ark of Covenant comes. So remember, every time he offers sacrifices, he has to clean that place completely white before they could go for next 6 feet. Next 6 feet. That must have been one long service. So you will worship God without minding the time and the energy it takes off you when you're grateful. Gratitude teaches you how to spend time in the presence of God. He didn't mind it. He didn't care. I'm in the presence of God. It's a gift to me. So I get to spend as much as I want in his presence. What a day it must have been for David. That's why God didn't even bother how he is dancing there. What does it matter now? This guy's heart is clean. He loves me. So whether he has clothes or not, really doesn't matter. Have you ever wondered why God did not? Because he's a father. At the core, he's a father. All of us now, the present generation, have the phones, the privilege of shooting our children bare naked dancing in front of us. We all have videos on our phones, right? Our children. How come we don't scold them at our home when they are in our presence and they're dancing their way out? You shoot them, you share them on reels, saying, look at how cute my child is. That's what God must be doing on that day. Look at how cute my child is. It's a contempt to Michal, not to God. God must be doing all those Insta reels at that point of time. Look at David. Michael, that's a proud father. That's why David didn't get killed on that day. His heart was clean. His actions then didn't matter to God. How he worshiped didn't matter to God. There's no descent or no descent. What does it matter? He's worshiping me. So may we come to that place where we worship him with out of gratitude for the presence that has come to us as a gift. Worship must be offered at a cost. Not at our convenience. Not when you want it. Not how you want it. But how God wants it. For that you need to pay, please pay for it. Pay extra for it. Why not? Why not? He paid a lot, right? He already paid the biggest cost he can to give you the access into the presence of God. Why not pay for it? May we learn to pay for the presence of God. You know? Not capstone. That's not what my point is at all. So don't just cut this portion and put it on YouTube. Pay for the presence of God. Pay with your life. Pay with all that you have. David did that. Consecration cannot replaced by convenience. Our worship should never be offered without sacrifice. David learned that. We learned that. May we come to the presence of God with fear, with trembling, and go out of here fearless, like David was. Let's close our eyes. What a privilege it is for us this morning to come into his presence. What an honor it would be for us to be alive and to go out of here, knowing that God spared my life today. The Holy God allowed me into his presence and given his presence as a gift to me. May you have the fear of God today. If you don't, ask God to put fear in your heart. Fear of him. Reverence for him. So that you can become fearless. Would you stand in his presence? You know, I want to give this call to every one of us. There are no choices today. Every one of us, we stand in his presence and worship him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. We worship you, God. In your presence, God, we acknowledge how wonderful, how beautiful, how holy and awesome you are here in your presence. Truly, we are undone, God. Thank you for opening yourself to us. You don't have to, you did. Just because we are loved into your presence, thank you for reminding us that we cannot take you for granted. We cannot disrespect your presence. If there is any one of us who are carrying irreverence for you, would you forgive us? Would you take that oppressive hand away from us? may you show favor to us, God, today. David learned it. We want to learn it. David responded to his learning. We are responding. We're saying, God, we're sorry. Not just because we are afraid, but because we know that this is a privilege. This is a gift from you, free gift. So may we receive this gift, your presence, with reverence, with gratitude. We want to do that, God. Help us. Not just today, but from today till the day we die, may we live in reverence of you, in obedience to your commands. May we, God, live our lives with gratitude. Thank you, God, for speaking to us here in your presence. Thank you for undoing us and reconstructing us today. Bless you, God. Bless you. We truly want to worship you, God. From the bottom of our hearts, it's pleasing to you when we worship with a clean heart. And that's what we want to have in your presence, clean hearts. Thank you for speaking to us today. May we never forget this lesson. Never. Whether we come back here into this church or whether we gather in plugins, wherever we go, may we always remind ourselves of the gift of the presence of God. Thank you. Bless you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray.